There is no place to even shop. There's no place to even get an ice cream. Nothing. You gotta get in a car to go everywhere. So they're saying, okay, we're gonna put public transit here and here. So we're gonna densify, but only we're gonna put all of these houses, they're gonna stay the same. So the people that are horrified of the density, don't worry. All of you are gonna have the house except that now if you live here, you're gonna have public transit within walking distance. Also within walking distance, you're gonna have restaurants and coffee shops and bookstores and grocery stores and convenience and all kinds of things. So this is some of the things they're doing. I mean, what's so nice about this? So they're telling people that are doing renderings and say, for example, the buildings cannot be wider, I mean taller than the width of the road. At the street level, it has to be retail at the street level and housing from the second level up. And this is totally doable. When I was looking today at the street here where you got the streetcar, I mean, almost everything is one or two stories. It would be so magnificent if it was five or six. And then it would totally revitalize. If you are gonna grow by around 25% the population of the greater Tucson in the next 30 years, it would be so magnificent if all of the 25 was in the downtown. You would have one of the most vibrant and exciting downtowns in America. I mean, why do you wanna save this when this could be six stories? There is nothing to save there. You're already doing so, but you gotta do much more like that. This was so exciting, a building that was kind of okay. You do all of this in front and you get all of this retail and it becomes vibrant and exciting. So this could be, the transit corridor has to be really magnificent. Be changed. Just a couple of images of Rotterdam. Look, they were also suffocated by cars. This is in the last 5 years. They took away the cars on one side. Look, you wanna live here or you wanna live here? Is that clear? The kind of changes that they are doing. This is the difference between having cities for people or cities for cars. That's where they got their tram, their streetcars, and put in the green. The New York effect. The New York, I love New York not only because I ran my first marathon there, but because these two women are transforming New York. They were on the Bloomberg, Janet Sadikan and Amanda Burden, magnificent. They had places like Broadway. They had the bike lanes. Who uses bike lanes painted? The cars and the kamikazes. Then they started doing physically separated and then people started using it. It's about that. It's totally dual everywhere. You can do this. Again, it's not about copying, but you can adapt and improve. Look, bringing out, taking out spaces and make it improving. Look at this crosswalk. You have so much better weather than New York. Your crosswalk would be so much nicer. They had a lot of these pocket parks. Not one or two, over 120 pocket parks. They turned this into this. You know, the nice thing about all of these pilots, initially you do it only for 2 years. So you go and say, okay, cars, move out. We're gonna do a small park. It's a pilot project only for 2 years. And then the car owners say, oh, this woman is crazy. But let her do it because it's only for 2 years. And then Janet goes in with the paint and the umbrellas. And 2 years later, she takes out the paint and puts real grass. So it's, be bold. If you had told anyone 10 years ago that Times Square was gonna be pedestrian, they would have thought you were crazy. Well, they made it pedestrian. So this is completely doable. So these are the kind of changes that can happen. It's, who would have thought that people were gonna be doing yoga and Tai Chi and things at Times Square? And then these things change. Some of you might know who Shania Twain is. Well, Shania Twain is from Timmins, 43,000 people. The mayor of Timmins called me and said, Gil, I said, 10 minutes, so it's like five left. She said, Gil, you gotta come and see this park. And I said, I'll go, but why? She said, because 2 years ago you came by and you were talking about pilot projects in New York. She could have said, oh, my city's 43,000, I got nothing to do in New York, I'm just gonna text. No, she paid attention. And she liked the idea of pilot. And she went back to Timmins, brought out the plants and the chairs and the table and created a park. So that's the idea. Let's open up everything that we're talking about is totally doable. The Buenos Aires, they went to New York, they saw what they were doing. He's the Minister of Transportation. She's the Director of Human Mobility. They don't call it active transportation, they call it human mobility. And all of the streets, there were four cars 5 years ago. Now all of them are pedestrians. Look at this, cars park and cars moving, and now they're pedestrian. They leave this so that the cars can come between 9 p.m. and 6 a.m. if they want to do deliveries in the stores. So all of this is totally doable. I mean, Buenos Aires does it, why not Tucson? It's a So, and again, it's not about copy, but take a look at what works, what doesn't work, and implement it. And this pilot project is nice because then you do it, you can do it overnight. People go home on Friday, they come back on Monday, and then it's done. And then they might get upset for 1 or 2 days. They were so proud that they had 16 lanes. Well, they took out 6, and now they're more proud because they have a bus rapid transit. And the mayor of Buenos Aires was elected president of Argentina last year. So let's focus on the benefits. This is not about the living streets. This is because living streets has so many benefits. Improve the culture, the festival, the activities, the ethnicity. Improve the education, getting the schools into the public places, the recreation, the environment. Have different benefits because each decision maker has a different benefit. Let me give you an example on health. Is this what the future looks like? We have a huge problem of obesity in the U.S. We have problems, obesity, heart attacks, and respiratory problems, and anxiety, and stress. More than 1 out of 3 people in the U.S. are obese. These are the 35 wealthiest countries in the world, and the U.S. is last. Doesn't make sense. And if we don't do something about it, it's going to go to 44%. And when people say, it's always been like this, it has not always been like this. 20 years ago, there was not one state that had over 20%. Today, there's not one state that has less than 20%. So we gotta work in many areas on this, having better school lunches. We gotta have farmers markets in all of the neighborhoods. We gotta have gardens in the schools. I saw that too. I heard that just now that one of the elementary schools is having gardens. We gotta have in the schools, in the parks, in the streets, everywhere. And we gotta be active. Just walking and cycling as a normal part of everyday life. This is kind of like the magic drug. It's good for strokes, for cancer, for osteoporosis, for high blood pressure. And it's not about doing marathons. It's only 30 minutes a day for adults, 60 minutes a day for children. And nothing, no better way to do it. Actually, no better way. No other way to do it than walking and cycling as a normal part of everyday life. There is no city in the world, none, that has more than 50% of the people active that is not walking or cycling. It's nice to organize soccer or baseball or what, but people do it twice a week. People don't do it 5 days a week. Or people don't go to the gym 5 days a week. But also, 1 out of 10 have depression. So there is no health without mental health. Depression today is the leading cause of disability. We really gotta work. If we have contact with nature, it's gonna improve our mood, our cognitive attention. We need to have nature everywhere, in our homes, in our streets, in our schools, in our parks, everywhere. If our neighborhood is green, it's gonna lower the depression, the anxiety, the stress. So it's not just because it looks nice, it's because it's gonna be good for our health. And last, the community, let's listen to the community. The community is the expert. If we're gonna do this park, let's not just do yoga and yoga and yoga everywhere. No, some people wanna have a fire pit, some people wanna have a pizza oven, others people wanna do exercise. There are all kinds of things, the children. Let's honestly listen. Sometimes we work with children and we ask them, how do a drawing, how do you want this neighborhood, how do you want your community to be when you have your parents' age and you have children of your age and they start doing drawings and it's exciting. And engage the children, not because they're the future. It's because if we educate the children, like Jamie Lerner from Curitiba says, if we educate the children very, very well, they go home and then they educate their parents. Look at this kid, he's only 13 and he wrote, I want few cars, more people walking, more people cycling. And then he didn't write, but he drew an area for pedestrians, for cyclists, for buses and for cars. He doesn't know that we walk at 3 miles an hour, but he knows that if we mix pedestrians and cyclists, the pedestrian is injured. We don't want any cyclists on the sidewalk. Sidewalk is to walk, sidewalk. We don't want mixing cyclists with cars because then the cyclist is gonna get injured. And then he drew public parks and low buildings with street level activity. Actually, my message tomorrow at the University of Arizona to the urban planning students, I said, guys, study very, very hard because now the 13-year-olds can summarize urban planning 101 in one row. So I want to end by saying, how do we want to live? That's the key. And one kid in the Cyclovia in Tucson had a really good idea. Don't be blue, be happy. It's about being happy. You know, happiness is one of the most difficult words to define, almost impossible to measure, but it is a reason to live. In many ways, that happens with most important things in our life, love, affection. So we need to think outside the box. These issues are not technical. They are not financial. They are political with a big P. Everybody needs to participate. We need to create alliances. It's like a three-legged stool. One of the legs are elected officials. Hopefully elected officials that want to do as elected and not just be. We need public sector staff, but not just planners. We got to get public health, environment, education, economic development. And we got to get the community, the activists, the media, the university, all of you. How do we get all these three legs together? What is the glue? Well, the glue is the sense of urgency. We got to do it now. And when we have the sense of urgency, then you need a shared vision of how do you want Tucson to be. And then the action. Some cities have the vision, but they have no action. So they know what needs to be done, but they don't do it. So they become frustrated. Other cities have action, but no vision. They do a little here. They're always doing things, but it's like a Frankenstein. It's total chaos. But if you have vision and you have action, you're going to transform Tucson. You're going to create living streets, creating cities for all. And we're going to be able to move from talking to doing. And I know that you are doing, but you're going to do more and you're going to do it faster because it's about creating a Tucson that is vibrant with healthy communities where all people are going to live happier. So let's do it now. Thank you.